I'm Bob Height with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy here at PG National Resort and Spa, the home of the Honda Classic. Today we're going to discuss how to improve your direction off the tee box. Okay? Now we must first understand that the hinging of our wrist has a correlation with the club face and in turn the direction of our ball flight, which is key when faced with this demanding tee shot in the 18th of the champion course. Okay? Now, the two most common faults with regard to hinging the wrist is to cup the wrist, which can cause the club face to be open, indicated by the toe of the club pointing down, and two, to bow the wrist, which can close the face, causing the toe of the club to point skyward. Okay? Both of these can stem from an incorrect grip. Now, what I would suggest is to practice with a frisbee in your hand. So hold the frisbee as you would a golf club, and what this does is unconsciously allows you to hold the club in an ideal neutral position. Two knuckles exposed, a slight angle in your left wrist. It can also limit any hand manipulation, over rotating of the hands or delaying the release of the hands, okay? Remember, less compensation is better. Now, this also serves as an extension of the club face, so as we get to the top, if we cup our wrist, the frisbee will be touching my right forearm and pointing down, which indicates it's open. It also limits me from bowing my wrist, okay? Because my left arm is in the way. So because of this, it allows me to hinge my wrist properly, keeping the frisbee against my forearm and parallel to it, which allows me to square the club face at the top of the swing, okay? So after some reps, square at the top, square at the bottom, let's repeat that sensation with the club in our hands. Square at the top, square at the bottom, okay? Try this exercise and you'll improve your direction off the tee box. I'm Bob Height with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy here at PG National Resort and Spa, the home of the Honda Classic. Today we're going to talk about how to rid the second most feared shot in golf, that dreaded shank. If you're wondering what the most feared shot is, it's the one immediately following the shank. Now, the two causes that attribute to this unfortunate shot is one, that the body moves out toward the ball, and two, the hands and arms swing the club out toward the ball, either way, exposing the hosel. Now, I have a simple exercise, simply using a pull noodle, which we will refer to as our training tool noodle, by placing it on the ground under our heels and assume a nice athletic golf posture. And making a backswing pivot, your instincts will pull you forward. But to avoid getting grass stains on your teeth, let's pivot against the noodle, where you feel heel to heel on both sides. What this will do is stabilize your balance, maintain your angles and your posture, and maintain space from the ball. Now, once you've ingrained that with the club in your hands, let's go ahead and place that training tool noodle under our arms. Rather than letting the noodle disconnect from the body, let's keep that noodle connected on the backswing and the through swing. It's more effective if you make smaller, slower swings to sense the connection. Now, these drills as a marriage will improve your balance, your connection, and your ability to promote center hit contact. So stick this in your tool belt and you'll rid that nasty shank. I'm Bob Height with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy here at PG National Resort and Spa, the home of the Honda Classic. Now, do you have flying elbow issues? Well, if you do, then this segment is catered to you. Now, some of the faults that can cause such a tendency is that our arms hang out at address, and two, that our body is stagnant as the club swings away, which causes the arms to swing the club too far around and up. Then from this position, what it can do is compromise your synchronization, but also can cause your right hand to disconnect from your left, which then you cast the club to regain connection. Either way, you're gonna expel all your energy too early and bottom out prior to the ball, which compromises your contact and could certainly be an Achilles heel when playing these treacherous par threes on the bear trap. Now, I have a simple exercise using a driving range basket, okay? Let's put the driving range basket between your elbows and simply clap your hands. This will simulate your address position, where our elbows are facing opposite our hip joints, okay? But also as we move and pivot, rather than just using your arms, I want you to move the basket with your torso, keeping the basket between your elbows. This will not only improve your synchronization, but keep the elbows tighter, which promotes a better backswing and a more simplified downswing. So again, try this exercise with a dry and range basket and you will get rid of those flying elbow issues. I'm Bob Height with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy here at PGA National Resort and Spa, the home of the Honda Classic. There's certain fundamentals that dictate how we swing the club and the level of our performance, especially with regard to the grip. Now, the most common fault in the grip is to hold the club too high in the hand favoring the palm. What this does is promote tension, also causes the wrist to become immobile. So since we are unable to leverage our wrist, we instinctively search for leverage elsewhere, typically our arms, which reduces the swing arc and destroys any club head speed. It can also cause physical stress in the wrist, forearms, and elbows, which can possibly result in tendonitis or golfer's elbow. So to avoid such problems, let's go ahead and discuss how to properly hold and swing the club. Now, from a shake hands position, let's hold that club at 45 degrees diagonally through your fingers and then wrap your fingers around, okay? With both hands on the club, let's lower our arms where then the butt end is adjacent our waistline. As we bend forward and sole the club on the ground, let's maintain that relationship from the butt end to our waist. This ensures that the club remains in our fingers. Now, what this does is reduces tension and relaxes the muscles, which promotes more club head speed, but also eliminates any possible injury or stress when we impact the ground or the ball, okay? So holding that club more efficient in the fingers, most importantly, will also allow you to leverage your wrist. The more we can leverage the wrist, we can maintain the width in our arms and create more club head speed with less effort. So remember, hold the club correctly in your fingers and you'll improve your performance. I'm Bob Height with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy here at PGA National Resort and Spa, the home of the Honda Classic. Today we're going to discuss how to improve your swing plane. Now the swing plane is facilitated by our posture. The most common fault that I see in the posture is we tend to have a rounded spine angle, typically when we inherit lower back issues. Now what this can do is make it very difficult for you to rotate the body. So the body instinctively mobilizes either laterally or vertically. Now, if you have this tendency of raising up out of your original posture, the only way to recover is to revert back down in the posture, which consequently steepens your downswing plane, indicated by the butt end pointing down to my feet. I would advise you to practice on a side hill uphill lie located on the edge of any tee box. With club in your hand, as you sole the club on the ground, you immediately get the sensation of standing taller and more erect in your posture. Now, gravity is pulling you down the slope, so we want to counterbalance that by bending or hinging more from your hips, sticking your rear end up, and then just press yourself against the slope. Now, in that posture, you will have the ability to rotate more efficiently. If we can rotate, we can maintain our posture throughout the entire swing. Also, and most importantly, practicing on a side hill lie will give you the sensation of flattening your backswing and delivering the club from a shallower, more inside approach to the golf ball, which is an indication of if I extend the butt end, it should point somewhere where the club started. Remember, practice on a side hill lie and you'll improve your swing plane and lower those scores.
Hi, I'm
Matt Hilton with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy, and I'm here at PGA National Golf Resort and Spa at Palm Beach Gardens, which is the home of the Honda Classic. And I'm here on the 18th green with a nice short putt. And this is usually a length putt that a lot of my students express a real concern with. They usually set up over this putt, get all set up, and take too long of a backstroke, which makes them decelerate in order to not send that putt way by the hole, okay? And this is usually because they're more comfortable with a 15-footer, 10-footer, 20-footer. Those are more commonly the putts that they practice, okay? So something that's really gonna help you make those putts a lot more often is if we set up over this putt and really feel the same tempo back and through that you have on a 15-footer. Even though it's a little longer stroke, you're gonna feel, take that putter back and through. And if I want to feel that same tempo on this short putt, just move that putter a little shorter back. Back, through, so I can still accelerate that putter head through impact and get it to drive into that hole. So I set up, feel that back, through, and I can really have a good chance of making more of my share of short putts. Hi, I'm Matt Hilton with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy, and I'm here at PGA National Resort and Spa, the home of the Honda Classic. I'm on the 18th green here, and what really helped me with that 3-footer was the fact that I used the alignment, that line on the golf ball, in order to get my line of the putt and make sure that I'm actually aimed at the hole. That can be a really handy tip, and I'm sure we've all heard that before. But I wouldn't be too quick to jump to that tip all the time. There are times when we have a little bit of break on a putt where the speed is going to be a big factor in which line we play. So if I was going to hit that same putt, but it had another couple inches of break to it, I would want to make sure that we actually, instead of lining that ball up where we have the logo going to the hole, just go ahead and line the white part of the ball up somewhere in the direction of the hole so that we're not feeling like the direction is already dictated. Do not be too quick to jump to that technique, however, if you have a little break. The main reason is, if there's a little break involved, the line that I'm gonna play is closely related to the speed that I'm gonna play the putt as well. Okay, so if I line up that logo, I've already kind of cornered myself into playing a certain line at a certain speed. And so if there is a little break on the putt, be a little more casual with it. Just set up to the ball without using the logo, nice white on top of the ball, and I can really use my feel to set up and really knock in that putt very consistently anytime there's a little bit of break. Hi, I'm Matt Hilton with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy. I'm here at PGA National Resort and Spa, home of the Honda Classic. Most amateurs, when they set up over a putt that they really want to make, I see them deliberating over what the line is, what the line is, what the line is, and I usually end up seeing something like this as they set up, hey, we got the line right, but I never really gave that putt a chance to go in the hole. Okay, when you watch the Honda Classic this year, it's gonna come down to a key putt, and I want you to really pay close attention to what the pros are doing. And really, they're just focusing most of their attention on giving that putt a good chance to go in, getting that putt all the way to the hole. So a little drill that I have here for you is set up a little shaft behind the hole for yourself, and I want you to line up a few balls. Go ahead and hit those balls where you're not really even paying attention to the hole at all. Just hit a few putts where you're concentrating on stopping these balls on that line behind the hole, and I think you're gonna find you actually make your share of putts without really even trying, without worrying about the speed, without the worrying about the line at all. So we hit those putts in a nice sequence, and I think you're gonna find you're gonna give them plenty chance to go in without even really worrying about the line. So that's gonna be a good solid drill for you. Lay something a couple feet behind the hole, hit some putts, don't worry about the line, and I guarantee you make your share of putts without even really trying. We'll be right back. Hi, I'm Matt Hilton with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy, and I'm here at PGA National Resort and Spa, home of the Honda Classic. One of the main keys to consistent putting that not a lot of people realize is we want to eliminate as much excess motion in the stroke as possible. We don't want that putter moving around, opening and closing as we're trying to execute a stroke because our body is moving in all different directions. So a simple drill that I want to provide for you doesn't even involve the putter. What I want to do is make sure we first get in a good athletic setup, start with the weight in the balls of the feet, add a little knee flex, and bend from the hips so we feel over that golf ball with our eyes. But from there, we're going to drop our putter to the side and just put your hands out in front of you like so, touching the heel pads of your hands together and making sure your palms are facing forward. From there, you're going to get a good feeling for what your arms are doing working with your body, okay? Then I want to just rock those shoulders back and through, quieting down as much body motion from the lower body as possible, okay? Once you get a good feeling for that, go ahead and reach for your putter and see if you can emulate that stroke and that feeling with the arms with your putter in your hands. So you can go ahead and set up to a putt and execute it with as little going on as possible, and I guarantee that's going to add a little bit of consistency to your putting stroke. I'm Matt Hilton with the David Ledbetter Golf Academy, and I'm here at PGA National Resort and Spa, home of the Honda Classic. A lot of times I see my students making one major error relating to putting before they ever enter the course. I see them show up for their Sunday foursome and actually just hit a few 20-foot putts, very simply with no goal at all, just kind of swatting putts, talking about what their friends said funny at dinner last night, okay, without a goal in mind. I want to be real quick and provide you with a nice, simple example about how to warm up properly for a round. First thing you're going to want to do, you can see I've laid down here on the ground some alignment aids. Start with some nice, short, straight putts and use some alignment aids so you can tell which direction that you're actually hitting your ball, okay? And from there, it gets very simple. Now all I have to worry about is the distance control. So if I just lay a couple balls down and hit a few lag putts, getting the speed of the greens, but not to a hole, I want you to work on lagging these all the way to the fringe. A nice one-dimensional target. We don't need a hole yet. That's a two-dimensional target, distance and direction. So if I set up to these balls and just give a nice long lag, getting used to the speed of the greens as I roll those, because it's really going to give me a one-dimensional target. I'm not going to be too worried about any direction hitting to a hole. I just want to get a good feel for the speed of the greens. So lag them up to the fringe, okay? Now, without much trouble at all, I've got a good feel for my technique, and I've got a good feel for the greens and how they're rolling today. So as we do that little routine, we're going to find all the information that we need. Good direction, good solid technique, as well as getting the feel for the speed that I need going out onto the course. Now is time for that last minute ritual that you talk about. Take one ball, hit a few different putts, and see if you can get in the groove before your round. I guarantee that little routine is going to really help you shave some strokes on the putting.
My name is Ken McDonald, Director of Fitness here at PGA National Resort and Spa. Today I'm going to show you a quick assessment you can do in the comfort of your own home or at the driving range before you play. What we're going to take a look at is how much rotation you have the hip and how much rotation you have at the shoulder. We're going to combine the two into one movement. All you need are two clubs. We're going to place one club across the shoulders and we're going to put one club on the ground inside the trail leg. From this position, we're going to try to rotate into the backswing as far as we can, keeping our spine angle and keeping our left foot grounded. We're gonna try to break parallel here. We're gonna try to get past